Hi there, my name's Sophie Petsabine and I'm a child sleep consultant. I'm proud to be collaborating with Mori to bring you lots of sleep tips and sleep advice to help you and your children sleep better. Today's video is talking about schedules and how to manage the sleep schedules of a baby and a toddler. Now, I'm a mum of two gorgeous daughters, one of which is 10 months old and the other is 3.5, and I run a business as well, so I know what busy feels like. There's some real pressure points for sleep throughout the day, and today's video is going to give you some hints and tips on how to manage that. Now, when you have a newborn baby, they're really portable, their sleep is erratic, so it's okay for them to sleep out on the run, in the buggy, in the sling, etc. So for the first 6 to 8 weeks of life, this is great. Let them slot in with what's going on with your toddler. But when you get that moment where your baby starts to smile at you for the first time, that gorgeous moment, it's a really good cue for you to know that your baby is starting to get more aware of what's going on around them. And this is a great point for you to start with a routine. Now, one of the big pressure points I see, first of all, is that parents often are getting their baby just to slot in with what's going in with their established toddler's routine, whether that's nursery, childminder, groups, etc. Baby just slots in with that. And that's okay if you have a baby that's nice and adaptable and very easygoing. But with the families that come to me for help, it's often that their baby is a little bit more sensitive to their sleep needs and their sleep surroundings, and that sleep is really, really tricky, and you know that's pressuring the rest of the family. So my first piece of advice here is for you to balance the needs of both of your children. Now, you're a mum to two, both of them have got to be taken into account. Now, nursery and the school run in the morning can be a really pressurized time, because that first nap of the day is really, really important for your baby. And I think really important for that one to take place at home, because it's almost an extension of night sleep. Now, this nap often takes place when you are dropping off your child to nursery or to the childminder. So what can we do about that? So there's a few tips for you here. First one is to enlist the help of friends and family to support you with that drop off. So perhaps your partner can go into work a little bit late, or a friend or family member can take your child in for you. If not, perhaps the nursery can be a little bit flexible with the start times. Can your child start a little bit earlier or a little bit later, depending on when your baby wants to nap? Having that baby's first nap at home is really important. The next thing is groups. So does your child go to a toddler group, a gym group, swimming, or something like that? Often those groups again are going to take place at a time that your baby needs to nap. So what can you do about that? Can you change the classes just temporarily? Can you put them on hold and that you do something else with your toddler if the time of the class is really when your baby needs to nap? Perhaps you can change the time of the class, again temporarily, just while you're getting into a great routine with your baby. If that's not possible, then that's okay. You know, your baby is going to have to be flexible, and perhaps they need to sleep in the buggy on the walk to the class or in the car, or perhaps you can take a sling with you to get them to sleep whilst you're there. Again, that's all okay. I'm a mum, as you know, so yes, it has to be realistic and both children's needs taken into account, because you can't keep a toddler at home all day because they'll be climbing the walls. But what I would suggest on those days where you need to take your baby out to sleep out and about, that you be mindful that perhaps the other naps that need to happen can take place at home. So, you know, perhaps the first nap of the day can definitely take place in the cot, the lunchtime nap can be out on the run, and then perhaps the afternoon nap can be at home again. So really balancing the needs of the baby, because if you're having all of your naps in the buggy, in the sling, out and about, it's likely that your baby isn't getting the deep restorative sleep that they need, and that's when we start to see sleep challenges happening, perhaps at nighttime and bedtime. So that's the first pressure point. The second pressure point is bedtime, especially when you're solo parenting, so your partner isn't around to help you at bedtime, and you do think, oh my God, how am I ever going to do bedtime without it taking completely all of my evening when I'm just desperately tired and want to get some child-free time. So my big piece of advice here, your aim is to have a joint bedtime or a joint bedtime routine. So typically how I suggest that would look is bathing them together, getting them in the bath at the same time, or baby in the small bath, you know, by the side of the big bath, but being in the bathroom at the same time. Now, after you've done that, your toddler and the baby should go into wherever's baby's sleeping and put on their pajamas and get themselves ready for bed. Now, obviously, it depends on the age of your toddler and how capable they are. Are they able to put the pajamas on for themselves, or do they need a little bit of help? You might need to help them with that, or they can, you know, put their pajamas on and really help you with the baby, perhaps putting down the stickers on the nappy and really getting involved in that routine. Now, whilst you're reading stories, you can do that all together, and then you might be starting to feed and to nurse the baby. So what we want to do is to keep your toddler occupied. Again, their level of attention span is going to vary wildly. So there's a variety of things that you can do to help them. So it might well be that they're happy to sit in the room with you quietly reading a book or playing with a toy that's nice and quiet and not disturbing baby. If not, it might well be that they need to play in their own bedroom, again, playing something that's nice and quiet. And what you can do is to choose a particular game or a particular toy that only comes out at this time of night. So the child can look forward to that and know it's a special toy for them to play just at this time whilst mummy is putting baby to bed. It might well be that they have their own milk at this time and a very light bedtime snack, and that can occupy them then. But if all else fails, you know, I'm a mum and I'm realistic here. So if all else fails and you really need to keep your toddler quiet, then you can enlist the use of TV nanny or iPad nanny. Just something very calm for them to watch at the end of the day. Now, I don't recommend TV before bedtime or screen time before bedtime, but as I say, I'm realistic. I'm a mum, and to have a calm bedtime for both children is really important. And this is just a moment in time whilst you're getting into a great routine. So if you do that, go for it and don't feel guilty about it. But once baby has been settled and put down to sleep, then you can come in and spend that much needed one-to-one time with your toddler. They will be feeling the pressure of and emotions of their sibling arriving. As much as they might be ecstatic and over the moon and excited, they will be mourning that one-to-one time that they've had with you. They have had you to themselves for the whole of their lives, and now this little baby is coming in and they're quite demanding a lot of their mum's time. So it's really key that you don't rush their bedtime routine. Spend lots of time doing stories, lots of time chatting, lots of time cuddling. Please don't pressure them to go to sleep, because if they feel that pressure from you, this is when things can start to unravel at bedtime and the resistance can come. So they don't want you to leave, they want you to hold their hand, or they're just screaming and shouting. So spending that one-to-one time is really, really key to make them feel that you're still there for them, and that the baby is not going to completely drain you of every bit of energy that you have. So just to recap there on how to manage schedules. So the first one is the beginning stages when your baby is young. They're adaptable and that's great, but when it gets to around 6 to 8 weeks, start to introduce that routine. But bear in mind that baby and toddler's routines have to be juggled together. Don't let it swing more towards one. It's okay on a day-to-day basis, but really give both children the support that they need. Enlist lots of help, you know, try and change the classes that you have and the drop-offs time, just to be a little bit respectful of your baby's sleep schedule. And then on a bedtime routine, try and bring that together for both of their children and both of your sake. Again, being flexible, and keep your toddler occupied and involved as much as possible. So don't let them feel that they're in the way. You know, if they can't be quiet in the bedroom, then of course give them something that can occupy them in their own room just while you're settling baby. And so again, you're not rushing your baby's feed. And if you are, your baby will pick that up and will probably resist being put down to sleep as well. I hope you found that useful, and I hope to see you again in the next video. Take care for now.